Welcome to Wright's Chapel. We're the Aldis family. I'm Megan.
I'm John.
I'm Lily.
And Ethan.
We've been coming to Wright's Chapel for about 5 years. I'm involved with Building Better Moms and Mobile Ministry. Lily and Ethan are both involved with the Children's Church. As a reminder, today is communion, so make sure you get some juice or water as well as some crackers and bread. Also, check in below with your names so we know who's attending today. As always, have a blessed Sunday.
Hello and welcome to Wright's Chapel. My name is Tanya and I'm the Director of Connection Ministries. Thank you for joining us for worship today. If you haven't already, we'd like to ask you to leave your name and the name of those worshiping with you in the comments section. This is also a great time to greet one another and to say hello to those who may be new to online worship. If you have questions about Wright's Chapel or this ministries, feel free to reach out to me directly at tanya@wrightschapel.org, or you may call or text me at 540-604-0038. Thanks so much again for joining us. And may God bless you as Clay leads us into a song of praise.
Dog.
Rice Chapel. It is so good to have you in worship with us whenever it is that you are worshiping with us. My name is Charles. I'm pastor here at the church. So glad that you could join us. Pray that you will draw near to God as God draws near to you during this time together. Later in the service, we will be sharing in the sacrament of Holy Communion, and so would invite you to get your elements together for all in the room, whether that's some bread and wine or juice or water or crackers, that you'll want that later to participate in that sacrament. Also want to invite you this after this early evening, 6 o'clock, we're going to be having a chili dinner out back of the church. Clay's going to be doing an outdoor concert, and we'll have the fire pits going, and there'll be some hot dogs and hamburgers there for folks who aren't chili lovers, but inviting you to come, inviting folks to bring canned goods, box goods for our mobile ministry. Financial donations are great as well, as we support that ministry and what they're doing, as they're out there this morning, on Sunday morning, meeting with folks and praying with folks and passing out food to folks in our community in two different locations in our county. So look forward to hope you can come out tonight. Hope to see you then. Dinner starts at 6. Concert will start about 6:30. Also want to invite you, if you're watching with us now, to share any prayer requests that you might have. And we want to be in prayer and ministry with you. And if you're comfortable with that, you can type those into the comment section. And we want to share in prayer with you. Let us then go to God in prayer now.
Let us pray. Oh God, we thank you that you call us to live out our faith with one another. You call us to support one another, to encourage one another, to lift one another up, to correct one another. You urge us, God, to end the divisions among us. But even within the church, we ask, how is this even possible? With fists clenched and jaws set, we grip tightly to our perspectives and opinions, ready for battle with any who would challenge us. Too often we worship the God of being right. Desperate to belong somewhere, we cling to our tribes of our own making. We find our tribe in our political party. We find our tribe in our ideology or social position. We know it is not your way. Your way, God, is excellent. Your way is relationship, discipleship, neighborliness, servanthood. Help us to imagine it, O God, as we come to the table. Let the fellowship we have continue when we leave the table. Help us to imagine sitting down together and breaking bread. Teach us to share, God. Make us into your fishers of people. Or perhaps we must simply allow ourselves to be caught by you first. Let us be one community, a tangle of faults and foibles, yet held in your net of grace. We ask all these things in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray when we pray to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
The Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the universal church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Let us break bread together on our knees. Let us break bread together. Fall on my knees with my under the rising sun. Oh Lord, have mercy on me. Let us drink wine together on our knees. Let us drink wine together. To the rising sun, oh Lord, have mercy on me. Let us praise God together on our knees. Let us praise God together. To the rising sun, oh Lord, have mercy on me.
So I say, walk by the Spirit, you will not gratify the desire of the flesh. For the flesh desire which contrary the Spirit, and the Spirit which contrary the flesh. They are in conflict with each other, so that you are not to do whatever you want. But the fruit of the Spirit, love, is joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things there is no law.
We just thank all those who have helped us in leading our worship this morning. Thank you for what you do. Let us pray together. Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of all our hearts truly be acceptable in your sight. O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. So we have any Star Trek fans worshiping with us today? Star Trek, Next Generation, Voyager, Deep Space Nine. I'd love for you to comment and let us know if you can... If you consider yourself a Trekkie like me, my wife and I, we love Star Trek. We don't go to many movies, but when a new Star Trek movie comes out, you can be guaranteed that we will be there. Our favorite movies, though, are probably the most recent ones with the young Kirk and the young Spock and that. At home, we'll watch the reruns from all the series on TV. It's because of Captain Jean-Luc Picard that on cold nights I like a cup of tea, Earl Grey, hot. Then, of course, there's Spock and Bones and Scotty, Data, Seven of Nine, Worf. Now, when I say... that Amy and I love Star Trek. Let me qualify that by saying we've never been to a Star Trek convention. We've never dressed up in character like some of you crazy people. I don't speak any Klingon. I don't own a Klingon batleth. I do have this really cool Star Trek tie that I wear only on very special occasions. And I know we've got some other Trekkies in our church as well. Lori Brown was saying that her favorite character is Deanna Troi. Molly thinks Jean-Luc was the best captain. Terry Hurley, when she was in the Army, actually taught a class on racism using video clips from the original Star Trek. And then, Terry, she had her picture taken with George Taiki, or for you non-Trekkies, better known as Sulu. Terry is now, she's now my hero, best friends with Sulu. Bobby Hebert, though, from our church, he probably is the biggest Trekkie among us. He has the uniform, he has the phasers. Bobby, he still likes to play and pretend he's Captain Kirk. So just a little over 3 weeks ago now, how cool was it that 90-year-old William Shatner, Captain Kirk in the Star Trek series, joined a four-person crew to become the oldest human to blast into space. 55 years after Star Trek took to the airways in 1966, Captain Kirk was really there. Space, the final frontier. These are the voyages of the Starship Enterprise. And there he was, James T. Kirk. Now, some of you are asking, what does all have to do with the fruits of the Spirit? And I'm telling you, I think it has everything to do with it. Today, we start a three-part series on what the Apostle calls the fruits of the Spirit. And I want to begin with a question. Do you know who you were meant to be? When I ask that, I don't mean your career or if you're married. I'm not even talking about your outward appearance. But do you know who you were meant to be? Or asked another way, do you know who God intended you to be? In the New Testament book of Galatians, Paul tells all of us who we were meant to be. And Paul does so as he paints a picture of what God intended the human beings that God created to be like. Go ahead and say it with me, won't you? The fruit of the Spirit is joy, peace, love, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, and self-control. What Paul is saying is that as we grow as disciples of Jesus, that these fruits should be becoming more and more visible in our lives. These fruits we bear become the evidence of a life lived in relationship with God. Now, Paul makes it very clear that these fruits are the gifts of the Holy Spirit. These qualities of character come to us as gifts. And yet we also recognize that we have a part to play in growing the fruit as a part of our lives. That's how God set it up. Sticking with the metaphor Paul uses for a moment, neither of us can grow apples out of nothing. We first must be given the seed, right? The gift of the seed is essential. A seed that has the potential to grow. Our part in the process is that we plant the seed, we fertilize the seed, we weed around the growing plant, we water, we cultivate the seed so that it will eventually produce the desired fruit. And it is the same with the fruit of the Spirit. God has placed within us the gift of the seeds for love and patience and kindness and joy. And now our part is to cultivate those seeds so that they may produce the fruit that God desires. Without the gift of the seed, nothing grows. But with the seeds, if we do our part, God will do God's part. And there will be an abundant harvest. It follows that if we are maturing as disciples of Jesus, if we are cultivating the fruits of the Spirit of God, then we should be more loving, we should be more kind, we should be more patient, more generous, more faithful, more loving at age 40 than we were when we were 15 or when we were 5. As we cultivate those seeds and as the fruit of the Spirit grows in us, we should be gentler. We should have more peace, more joy, more self-control at age 50 or 60 or 80 or 90 than we did at 45. And yet, friends, I tell you, as I look at my own life, sometimes I'm not so sure that that is always the case. And yet when I reflect upon that and I'm honest with myself, I know that that has to do more with me and my cultivation of the seed and not so much with God and God's gift of the seed. I mean, really, think about it. No one dreams about growing up to be unloving, unkind, impatient, and selfish. And so what happens to us along the way? How can we grow to be the kind of people we want to be? How do we grow to be the people God meant us to be? It's no accident that Paul writes that the first fruit that should be growing in the life of the Christian is love. Love is the fruit that Jesus is speaking of in John's gospel when Jesus says to his disciples, "This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you." For Jesus, love is the greatest of all the commandments. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, and strength, and you shall love your neighbor as yourself. In a sense, all the other fruits of the Spirit are encompassed in this fruit of love. All the eight other fruits that Paul lists are in some ways a byproduct of the fruit of love. We get the love growing right, and then all the other fruits will follow. But can I tell you that neither Jesus nor Paul is referring to love as we often take that word to mean. And I realize that some of you may have gone through this before, but it's important, so I want to go through it again. In the Greek language of which the New Testament was written, there are four different words that are translated love in the English language. Four different types of love in the Greek. There is the Greek word eros, used to describe that erotic, that sexual type of love that we sometimes feel. There is the Greek word philia, to describe the love that one has for family members, for one's children, for one's relative. There's another Greek word used for the love that one might have for their community or for an organization, a type of food one really likes. Like, I love chocolate, right? But the Greek word that Jesus uses and the word that Paul uses for love when he lists love as one of the fruits of the Spirit is the word agape. Agape is actually used more than any other word for love in the New Testament. 116 times in the New Testament is used to describe love. And the best definition I've heard is that agape love is the dogged determination to show kindness even when kindness is not deserved. When Jesus says that you shall love your enemies, agape love is the kind of love Jesus is describing. When Jesus said to his disciples, "I command you to love one another," agape love is what Jesus is requiring. That love is a love that is played out in action and not necessarily in feeling. And don't get me wrong, feeling love is great. Nothing wrong with your heart skipping a beat when you're in love, but rather agape love, love as a fruit of the Spirit, is that love which is lived out in our actions and how we treat one another with kindness, regardless of how we might feel about the person or feel about the situation, whether or not kindness is even deserved. I had the privilege a couple of weeks ago of officiating at the marriage of my nephew and his wife, Prakriti. And they wanted that famous biblical passage from Corinthians read where Paul talks about love, and I suspect many of you have heard it. Paul starts out so poetic and so beautiful, maybe even for some romantic. "If I speak in the tongues of mortals and of angels, but do not have love, I am a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. And if I have prophetic powers and understand all mysteries, but do not have love, I am nothing." But then let me tell you, friends, you read through that passage, Paul very quickly gets really practical. Paul gets down to earth. Paul tells us where the rubber meets the road when it comes to love. This is what love really is. Agape love, Paul says. Love is patient and love is kind. Love is not arrogant. Love is not rude. Love does not insist on its own way. Love is not irritable or resentful. Love bears all things. Love believes all things. Love hopes all things. Love endures all things. Love, real love, agape love, it never ends, says Paul. Now, I don't I don't know about y'all, but I don't have a whole lot of folks that I would call my enemies. At least not today. I don't have that many enemies. But like most of you, I have a few folks in my life I don't particularly like. I have folks who annoy me, folks who frustrate me, folks who get under my skin. I thought about showing some of their pictures here on the screen today, but Amy told me that wouldn't be a good idea. Sometimes I lack the fruit of common sense. My wife produces a lot of that common sense, so that's good for me. But come on, let's be honest. I've got certain folks. You've got certain folks in your life. And I'm not going out of my way to be mean to them. But I would also have to admit that I don't normally go out of my way to be pleasant to them either. Usually, I just try and avoid any contact with them. And I mean, come on now, y'all do this too, so don't act like I'm some axe murderer here. I'm getting ready to turn down the aisle. Excuse me, at Food Line. And I see that person, and I think to myself, oh, Lord, oh, Lord. And usually what I do is I just turn and go down a different aisle. I'll come back later for what I was looking for, and I'll just avoid the situation. But Jesus says, when you are growing the fruit of agape inside of you, that kind of love is different. Love that grows within us as the fruit of the Spirit is different. And that as we grow in Christ, we seek more and more and more, not just to avoid certain people, but rather to show love and to show kindness to all people, regardless of how we might feel. And can I just tell you, that's tough to do. That's hard work. It can be hard at times just to be kind to the people we like, to the people we live with. With the folks that I try and avoid, well, I was hoping that maybe just not being mean would be enough. But Scripture tells us no. That as we grow in Christ, the fruit of love should be growing on us as well, which causes us not just to avoid meanness, but to rather show kindness. Can you imagine a world where humans were always practicing love? It was in 1970, Louis Armstrong was being criticized for his song, What a Wonderful World. Criticized in light of all the suffering and conflict in the world at that time. And this is what Armstrong said in light of that criticism. Watch this.
Some of you young folks been saying to me, hey, Pops, what you mean, what a wonderful world? How about all them wars all over the place? You call them wonderful? And how about hunger and pollution? They ain't so wonderful either. But how about listening to old Pops for a minute? Seems to me it ain't the world that's so bad, but what we are doing to it. And all I'm saying is, see what a wonderful world it would be if only we'd give it a chance. Love, baby, love. That's the secret. Yeah. If lots more of us loved each other, we'd solve lots more problems. And man, this world would be a guesser. That's why old Pops keeps saying, I see trees of green, red roses too. I see them blue for me and you. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. Ooh, yeah.
Well, the only way that happens in our life, I believe, is if we are intentional about cultivating that love, that kindness in our life. The only way for agape love to grow in us is for us to set our focus upon it, to wake up in the morning, every morning, and for the first thing to ask God to make us a more loving person. God, show me today in every situation that I might face what the loving thing to do is. Lord, as I deal with my kids who are driving me nuts right now, what is the loving thing to do? With my spouse, God, who I just feel us drifting apart, what is the loving thing to do? Lord, with the guy at work who is so annoying, Lord, what is the loving thing to do? Lord, with my neighbor who always votes the wrong way and for the wrong people, Lord, what is the loving thing to do? Before we respond to a difficult person or to a difficult situation, be ready to first ask ourselves, God, what's the loving thing to do here? It was Mother Teresa once said that not all of us can do great things, but we can all do small things with great love. And I got to tell you, I don't know that will necessarily get you a clear answer from God every time as you ask that question. Sometimes the loving thing to do is not always so apparent. Let's just be honest. But I do believe that as we intentionally focus on that question over time, day after day, we will slowly but daily begin to bear the fruit of love, and thus we will become more loving. And so that takes me back to Captain Kirk, to William Shatner. After spending much of his life pretending to be an astronaut, pretending to be a space traveler, finally, at age 90, Shatner stopped pretending. And I loved what Shatner had to say after he landed and he stepped out of the capsule. Listen to this.
You've given me is the most profound experience I can imagine. I'm so filled with emotion about what just happened. I just, it's extraordinary. I hope I never recover from this. I hope that I can maintain what I feel now. I don't want to lose it.
What you have given me is the most profound experience I can imagine. It is extraordinary. I hope I never recover from this. I hope I can maintain what I feel now. I don't want to lose it. Can I just say, friends, that this is what happens when you stop pretending and live into and become what God intended for you to be. And you and I, we were meant to bear fruit. God made us for this. The night before his death, Jesus told his disciples, and I believe that Jesus is speaking those same words to us today. Jesus said, "You did not choose me, I chose you. And I appointed you to go and to bear fruit, fruit that will last." What does that fruit look like? The fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. My Vulcan friends might say, "Live long and prosper." I say to you, my friends, live long and love well. Peace and amen. Can I just say thank you for the gifts you give to Life, our church, just to allow us to do so much ministry. One of the things that we've been able to do over the last year and a half is set up this online ministry that we've been doing that involves not only online worship, but online classes and And on November the 14th, we're even going to give folks an opportunity, been watching us online and participating online with worship, to join the church online in a coffee with the pastor. And if that's something you're interested in, we'd love to have you join us from wherever you're at. You can just comment in the comment section and say, yes, yeah, send me the link for that online Zoom. It's going to be at 12:15 on November the 14th. Have a chance to talk, you and me, and with some others, learn more about Rice Chapel, and join the church if you'd like to on that Sunday. That's next Sunday on the 14th. But I wanted you to hear about a little bit what's going on with our online ministry and the work that we're doing there.
So each Sunday morning, I actually support online ministry. So in partnership with Ginger Abbott, who's also a member of the church, we support online ministry. So I do YouTube and Ginger does Facebook. So when we're commenting online, you're actually speaking to us. We actually greet everybody that joins us. We share the announcements for the week, any upcoming events, and we'll also share the prayer requests that come through, any scripture readings. We'll actually put those out there in case individuals who watch after the fact, they can go back and read the scripture reading themselves. We have people who are joining from Spotsylvania, Hanover, King William, North Carolina, Kentucky. So it's just really, really exciting.
I get a feeling of connection with the church. You know, there's an interactive part of the church where people are responding. You know, the first thing that you all do is ask people to check in, which is terrific. That was just like, okay, yeah, they know I'm here and they want me to be here. And so that you know, was really good.
We prefer doing the online because we can watch it when we want to versus having to be there at a specific time. If there's a kid crying, we can pause it and then, you know, get back to it.
A lot of times Amy will do Bible studies after church, so after the service we have here, and we now have them to where individuals who want to be in person can watch it in person, or they can actually watch it online. Recently, Charles has started doing an online Bible study in reference to Romans, and we actually had double attendance than what we've had in the past.
I love that I get a little Facebook notification that reminds me to tune in. Other than that, I love being able to sit down with my family in the comfort of our own home and not feel like my daughter crying or my son constantly talking is interrupting anybody else worshiping.
The church that I attend also offers an online service, but it's basically just someone standing up there and reading the scripture and the sermon with no interaction. You know, there's not a lot of connectivity or feeling like you're part of the service.
It helps people because they can still ask questions, they can make comments, they can make recommendations, they can share their prayer request. And so we work with other ministries just to, again, help people feel engaged and involved.
It went from finding it through my uncle to watching it virtually to not wanting to miss a Sunday, even traveling. We are literally in the car on Facebook, listening to it through the speakers, to going into the actual church to baptize our daughter, and now we can't wait until we're able to go back up.
You know, outside service, inside service, online service, folks can be connected. And I think that's the big thing is community and connection. So it's exciting to be able to have what I would call a church anytime or anywhere.
And so if you have your elements with all those who have gathered, we take the bread, the crackers, and remember that on the night in which Jesus gave himself up for us, he took the bread and he gave thanks to God and he broke it. And he gave it to his disciples and he said, "Take, eat, for this is my body that is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And in the same way, after supper, he took the cup and he gave thanks to God and he gave it to his disciples and he said, "Drink from this, all of you, for this is my blood of the new covenant. It's poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Almighty God, pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and the blood of Christ, that we might be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with each other and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. With your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, both now and forevermore. Amen. And so I invite you to take your bread, your crackers, to break a piece off for each person, and as you do, say the body of Christ given for you, and then to take that and dip that into the cup and say the blood of Christ shed for you, and to then partake. And let us pray. Lord, we thank you for this sacred meal, which reminds us of your love for us and calls us to go out into the world and to love others. That we are to grow this fruit of the Spirit within our lives, that we might become who we were meant to be, created by you. Thank you for your love and your grace in our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let me share this benediction with you, and then Clay will lead us into a final song of praise. That we might go forth into this world in peace and be of good courage. Hold fast to what is good and render to no person evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted and support the weak. Help the afflicted. Honor every person, love and serve the Lord, rejoicing in the powers of the Holy Spirit. May the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep our hearts and our minds in Christ Jesus, both now and forevermore. Amen.
Sing, how great is our